الحمد لله، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والعاقبة للمتقين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وإمام المتقين، وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ومن آياته منامكم بالليل والنهار. وقال حبيبنا محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: لم يبق من النبوة إلا المبشرات. قالوا: وما المبشرات؟ قال: الرؤيا الصالحة، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام: رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. Alhamdulillah, through the sheer mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, tonight is the 93rd lesson of Riyadu Salihin. I wrote on the reminder, on the WhatsApp reminder, that we're going to start the chapter of Salam. However, before that, last week I mentioned that there's one more chapter before that, which is a chapter of dreams and dream interpretations. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to touch upon this inshallah. And if time permits, then I will start Kitab al-Salam. If not, then we will end on dreams. Bab al-Ru'ya wa ma yata'allaku biha is chapter number 130 in Riyadu Salihin. Imam al-Nawbi, whenever he starts a new chapter, he always starts, and he tries to start with, rather not always, but majority of the times he starts with a verse from the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first hadith, wa an Abi Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu qal, sami'tu Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yaqul. The great Abu Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu says, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, لَمْ يَبْقَى مِنَ النُّبُوَّةِ إِلَّا الْمُبَشِّرَاتِ قَالُوا وَمَا الْمُبَشِّرَاتِ قَالُوا الرُّؤْيَا الصَّالِحَةِ. There is nothing left from prophethood except for mubashirat, glad tidings and good newses. The Sahaba radiyallahu ta'ala anhum said, Ya Rasulullah, wa mal mubashirat? What do you mean by glad tidings, good news? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ar-ru'ya saliha, a pious, a true dream. Before continuing, I've mentioned a few times also that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions in a hadith that the messengers of Allah, for them, their dreams are revelation, a wahi. The dream of a Nabi of Allah is wahi. It is a form of revelation. From this, the ulama explained Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam amongst the glorious Quran, the verses of the glorious Quran, some verses were revealed via a ru'ya saliha, by these dreams also. My Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before the verses of Surah Qul A'udhu bi Rabbin Nas and Qul A'udhu bi Rabbil Falaq was revealed, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was informed via a dream, regarding the young boy who had sent the pieces of hair of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the Jewish lady who had then used it against Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the 11 pieces of hair that she had tied knots on. So this was given to Rasulullah through a dream. My Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam had certain visions, amongst them the Mi'raj, which was when the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the ascension, where the physical body of Rasulullah went to the heavens. However, there are other narrations where we find Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also experienced such things via dreams also. So the dream of a Nabi is true. From amongst the Nabis of Allah, a famous incident that me and you will be aware of because of Eid al-Adha is the incident of Ibrahim alayhi salam, where he himself says to his child Ismail, فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعُ السَّعِ قَالَ يَا بُنَيَّ, O my beloved child, إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى, that I see myself in my dream that I am slaughtering you. فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى, what do you think regarding this? You give me your opinion. So this was in a dream, because the dream of a Nabi is wahi, is revelation. For them to act upon it is the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To this day and age, how many types of dreams are there? My respected teacher, Shaykh Sufi Sahib Hafizahullah ta'ala, explained there are three types of dreams. Number one, those dreams which are ru'ya saliha, those dreams that are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, either as good news or as a warning against something. This is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, those dreams that are attributed from shaitan. Iblis, shaitan, he whispers and he puts certain thoughts and certain dreams inside the human being, and this human being experiences this. Number three, according to your day-to-day activity, those things that have wondered and pondered over you, those things that are in your mind, when you sleep with this. For example, once a person, he came and said, how do I see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in my dream? So the respected Shaykh said that before you sleep, sleep thirsty. Don't sleep with water. Spend a whole day without water. So that person, when he went to sleep that day, he didn't see Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He saw himself bathing in an ocean. So he went to the Shaykh the next morning, Al-Fajr, and said, Shaykh, you said to me, I want to see Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, don't drink water all day. Make sure you go to sleep thirsty. I went to sleep thirsty. Forget seeing Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I see oceans and I'm swimming in oceans. So then the Shaykh explained, because you are thirsty all day, the thing that you're in need of is water. So your whole day is revolved around the need of water. So when you slept, the thing that you see is that thing connected to water. So if your day is according to the way of Rasulullah, if your life is according to the way of Rasulullah, and you are spending time in giving durood, salutation upon Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then definitely a day, a night will come in your life when you will have to see the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is all about the want and the zeal. So this is the first hadith that we understand from this. The next hadith. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أبو هريرة narrates من رآني في المنام فسيرى أني في اليقظة أو كأنما رآني في اليقظة لا يتمثل الشيطان بي. My respected teacher here opens a very important can of worms, which is seeing Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم in your dreams. Here my Nabi says that person who has seen me in his dream, definitely he will see me when he is awake. What does this mean? And in another hadith we find that person who has seen me in a dream, definitely he has seen me because shaitan cannot take my figure and cannot take my appearance. Number one, the ulama explained when Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this hadith, this saying, this was directed only to the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sahaba. So some sahaba radiallahu anhu, before being given the mantle of being a sahabi, of sahabiyat, they would come towards Islam. For example, they would travel towards Medina. Before coming to Medina, in their travels, they would see Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in their dreams. So whoever saw Rasulullah in their dream, that means definitely, he will definitely reach Medina and he will see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the physical form. That is one interpretation. And that's an interpretation which is acceptable, but only for the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. However, Hafiz ibn Hajr al-Asqalani rahimahullahu ta'ala says, no, that's only exclusive for Sahaba. Then how do you explain those that see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after the Sahaba radiallahu anhum? So then Hafiz ibn Hajr al-Asqalani says, the real correct meaning of this hadith is two. Number one, that person who sees me in a dream, definitely he will also see me in real life, definitely on the day of Qiyamah, inshaAllah. He will recognize Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Seeing Rasulullah and recognizing him is two different things. Many disbelievers saw Rasulullah. They did not recognize Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as the Nabi of Allah. They saw him to be Ahmad, to be Muhammad, but did not seem to be Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But a person who sees Rasulullah in his dream, definitely he will see Rasulullah in the hereafter and will recognize him in the state of Iman. Number two, if you see Rasulullah in your dream, then definitely no, there can be no difference of opinion. You have definitely seen Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in your dreams. So this is a fact. In this day and age also, if you were to see the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in your dream, then definitely you have seen Rasulullah in your dream. There can be no doubt about it. So the question is, but how do you know? How do you know? Because in your dream, if you say, this is the Rasul that I am seeing, know that definitely this is the Rasul that you are seeing. Shaitan cannot take the appearance of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? However, if you were to converse with Allah in a dream, we can say to you, there is a chance that shaitan has manipulated your dream. But if you were to see Rasulullah, definitely you have seen Rasulullah. Why the difference? The ulama explain, Rasulullah is rahmatul lil alameen. Rasulullah's whole existence, his whole body, everything about him is rahmah, mercy, mercy, mercy. Shaitan is completely away from mercy. He cannot impersonate mercy, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But my Allah, your Allah, has certain attributes. Amongst Allah's attribute is Ar-Rahman, the most merciful. Ar-Rahim, the most beloved, benevolent, the most merciful. However, Allah is also Al-Jabbar, the most powerful. Allah Ta'ala is also Shadidul Iqab, the one that punishes severely. Allah Ta'ala within His attributes, He has the attributes of ghadab, of anger. Allah has the attributes of punishment, severe punishment. Allah Ta'ala has the attribute of taking away from mercy. Shaitan can take away from mercy. My Allah can take away from mercy. So Shaitan has the ability that in a dream, trick a person, say, I am Allah, believe that I am Allah and Allah is speaking to you. And he can do this. But with Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, no, he cannot. Because Rasulullah is a true entirety, one entirety of mercy, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Seeing Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in the seerah, in Shama'il al-Tirmidhi, we have a physical description of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I have mentioned this a few times before also, that Rasulullah had a thick beard. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to have a distance between his eyebrows. My Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to have a beautiful arched sort of eyebrows. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to have beautiful clear skin. His cheeks, there was a reddish tint to the beard of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the face of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to have a few white hairs, as we find in ahadith in his later life. My Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to have a zulfa, sometimes he used to have short hair, sometimes a hair up to here. So there's a difference. So when you will see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, some people report and say, I have seen the Nabi of Allah, but I've seen him without a beard. Some will say, I have seen the Nabi of Allah in my dream, but I have seen him with long hair. Some will say, I have seen the Nabi of Allah in my dream with short hair. Some will say, I have seen the Nabi of Allah in such a state where he is angry with me. Some will say, I have seen the Nabi of Allah in such a state where he looks, he is very dark. So what's the answer to all this? We know Rasulullah has one figure. His figure doesn't change. His appearance does not change. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What's the answer to this? The ulama explained, Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, you see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the lens of your condition of your iman. So when some people they see Rasulullah without a beard, for example, why is that the case? Because the lens that you are seeing the Rasul in is because you don't have a beard. So the lens and the glasses that you have worn to see the Rasul is such a lens that the beard of Rasulullah has been covered from your eyes. That is one example. Some people see Rasulullah is angry. Why is Rasulullah angry? It is possible because of your own condition. Rasulullah is not happy with you, so you seem in a state where Rasulullah is not happy with you. Some see the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a state where Rasulullah is not talking. Rasulullah is just there. Why? Some are blessed to see the Rasul in a state where he is just there staring at them. It's possible that you are not vocal regarding the sunnah. That's why Rasulullah is not speaking to you. For example. So there are different interpretations, different meanings. But to see the Rasul, know that you have definitely seen the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sometimes the Rasul will command you in a dream. Oh my ummati, do such and such a thing. Do you act upon that? If it is a command against Shariat, against Islam, then you not act upon this. If it is a command which is regarding Sharia, Rasulullah says in a dream, Oh my servant, oh my ummati, give sadaqah of 1,000 pounds. You bichara don't have 1,000 pounds. So for you to act upon that is not necessary, the ulama explain. You have not understood what Rasulullah said to you. There is an interpretation. It is not as clear and simple as it sounds. Seeing the Rasul is simple, it is clear. What he has said, how you have seen him, that is in need of some sort of interpretation. Because of this, it is a field in itself. Hafiz ibn Sirin, rahimahullah ta'ala, the one that wrote the first ever dated book regarding dreams and dream interpretations, he has put it together. For example, if a person sees in a dream, he is drinking milk, this is a sign that Allah will bless you with knowledge. For example, if a person sees in a dream that there is a snake there, it is a sign, it is an enemy. So different objects, different items, doing a different thing in a dream, refers to a different thing. You see the deceased, sometimes you will see the deceased. Sometimes that is a warning that you have forgotten your deceased, they have come to remind you to do Ithar al-Swab. Sometimes you see the deceased in a bad state, it is possible Allah is showing you Qabr al-Azab. So now you need to make dua for that person. Sometimes you see the deceased in a good state, They're wearing beautiful clothes. That is a sign that it is possible Allah has forgiven them and they're having a relaxed time in their qabr. So different things have a different sign, have a different. But you cannot make that sign up. You cannot think, mashallah, because I've seen someone happy, it means he's happy. No. I'll give you an example. My respected Shaykh, Hazrat Mawlana Yusuf Mutala Sal Hafidahullah, this person came to him. Listen to the dream and understand the dream and you'll understand what I'm trying to say to you. They came to Shaykh and said, Hazrat, oh, I'm very perishan. I'm so scared. What's up? Hazrat, I keep seeing in my dream that I open the Quran and I'm urinating on the Quran. Na'udhu billah. Urinating on the Quran. Na'udhu billah. Hazrat, what do I do? I'm so perishan. What have I done wrong? I read Quran. I do everything. I see myself in a dream. I open the Quran Sharif and I urinate on the Quran Sharif. So obviously our reaction is astaghfirullah. Hazrat said, have you told anyone this dream? He goes, yeah, I told my family members, I'm so scared, I don't know what's up. Hazrat goes, this is a glad tidings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Hazrat said, do you have a son? He goes, yeah. Do you know anything about your son? Where did he go? My son goes, maktab, okay. Allah ta'ala is telling you in your dream that your son is becoming a hafiz of the Quran. He asked his son, beta, how many paras have you done? He goes, I've done 29 paras, I'm nearly finished. He's becoming a hafiz of the Quran. So someone saw themselves urinating on the Quran. It wasn't a bad thing, because a person who understands the dream world and how to interpret, he has understood this is an indication from his nasl, the Quran is being printed, i.e. a person from his family is becoming a hafiz of the Quran. But what would we have thought? Astaghfirullah, such a bad dream. Opposite. Sometimes you see a good dream, yeah, I saw myself, you know, sunbathing. You know, it's like a temporary jannah. Chilling. That could be a very bad dream. Why? Ad-dunya sijnul mu'mini wa jannatul kafir. This world is a test and a prison for the believer and a paradise for the disbeliever. This could be a sign that your iman is weak. Example. So you cannot just interpret dreams out of your own wings and desires. It is an art. It is a specific art. It is a subject. It's a science. To understand dream interpretation, you have to study under such a teacher who has already developed this understanding, who has understood what it means to have a dream, what it means to interpret the certain words, certain ways. A person sees in a dream that their tooth has fallen off. That's sometimes an indication that your death is very near. But you wouldn't know that. You'd think, Ya Allah, tooth falling off, I'd go dentist. No. Different dreams, different objects in a dream have different interpretation. So if you see the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his dream, know you have seen it. If he instructs you otherwise than Shariat, if Rasulullah said to you in a dream, have a drink of alcohol, you will not act upon this. That you have not understood what Rasulullah said to you. This is why, if you have certain dreams and you're troubled by these dreams, go to certain ulama. Some people, not everyone, and I'm sorry, not every maulana, not every imam, not everyone knows these things. I myself, alhamdulillah, I've studied some of this with my respected teacher, Mufti Bahaul Islam, but I myself would not know completely all aspects of dreams, because I haven't studied it as a science. I've touched upon it, so I know certain things. So if I don't know it, I can't tell you. I can't make you on the spot either. If I don't know it, I'm sorry, I don't know. So you can't go to everyone. You might go to someone, he might tell you, mashallah, you saw yourself sunbathing, mashallah, you're going to Jannah, bro. But he might not mean that. So you have to be very, very careful. And another thing, best thing with this, with dreams, try to keep it with yourself. If it's a dream that's bothering you, inform the ulama. If it's a dream where you've seen a deceased in a good state, take it as, alhamdulillah, my sucha, my mother, my father is in a good state, make dua for them, thus leave it. You don't need to tell the whole world. Certain dreams you might need to, so you understand it further. But generally speaking, dreams, you shouldn't dwell into it too much, nor should you completely dismiss it. Have a balanced approach regarding it. A dream isn't the end all, and a dream isn't not insignificant. It is significant. So keep that in mind. Keep a very balanced approach. Allah gives us a tawfiq to understand this. My Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this advice I gave you is from my Rasulullah. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri says, سمع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إذا رأى أحدكم رؤيا يحبها رسول الله says, if you, from amongst you, if you see a dream which makes you happy, فإنما هي من الله تعالى, accept it to be from Allah, فليحمد الله عليها, praise Allah for this dream, alhamdulillah. So for example, I myself, I've been missing my teachers. I teach in Darul Bari, so for this last 6 weeks, I haven't seen a lot of my teachers. So So I'm just giving you guys an example. Two nights ago, in my dream, I saw myself. I was meeting my teacher, Hafiz Ahmed Saab. I shook hands with him. I saw another of my teacher, Mawlana Zia Saab. I was shaking hands with him. I was so happy because I'm longing to see them. Allah Ta'ala showed me my teachers in my dream. Alhamdulillah. So I was very happy when I woke up. So that's an example. Well, you had this biha. If you want to narrate it, you may narrate your good dreams also. So good dreams, alhamdulillah, no problem. فَلَا يُحَدِّثْ بِهَا إِلَّا مَنْ يُحِبُّ. But don't narrate it to everyone. Narrate it to those people who you believe that they won't have envy against you. They won't hate you. Some people, Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, what did he do wrong? In the way, when I say wrong, I mean the error in his initial time. What did he do?
He told
the dream to who? Not just his mum and dad, all of his 11 brothers. His mum and dad were very happy. Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam, when he heard that my son has seen in a dream that the sun, the moon, the stars are doing sajida to Yusuf, he understood, my son is going to be a Nabi of Allah. He is going to be a Nabi of Allah. Yaqub understood this. But his brothers saw it as, our brother is going to be more favored than all of us. They became jealous. So it's a good dream. Narrate it to your father, no problem. He won't have envy against you. But your brothers had envy against you, so do not narrate it. This is what my Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying. وَإِذَا رَأَى غَيْرَ ذَلِكَ مِمَّا يَكْرَهُ فَإِنَّمَا هِيَ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ فَلْيَسْتَعِذْ مِنْ شَرِّهَا. If you see a bad dream, a nightmare, you're being attacked, something bad, do not narrate it to others. As soon as you get up, say أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. First thing. Secondly, look at towards your left hand side. My Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaches, make a spitting gesture three times and then change your position of sleeping and carry on sleeping. This is the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you see a bad dream, get up. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Ya Allah, protect me. Change your position of sleeping. You continue to see it, do the same thing. Continue to see it, do the same thing. If a dream repeats itself, then that dream means there is some sort of value in that dream. Ibrahim's dream, Yawm al-Tarwiyah, 8th of Dhul Hijjah. He didn't see his dream once. The dream was repeated by Allah Ta'ala. Then he understood, I have to do the dhabiyah of my soul. So a certain dream, if it's repeated, same dream, same thing, then definitely there is something more to it. Inform someone, inform an alim, inform a sheikh, they will help you inshaAllah. My Rasulullah says, فَمَنْ رَأَى شَيْنَ يَكْرَهُهُ فَلْيَنْفُثْ مِنْ شِمَالِي ثَلَاثًا. If you see a bad dream, make the spitting gesture on your left hand side. وَلِتَعَوَّذْ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ, and seek refuge from shaytan. فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَدُرُّ inshaAllah, that bad dream will not have an effect on you. My Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ مِنْ أَعْظَمِ الْفِرَىٰ أَن يَدَّعِ الرَّجُلِ إِلَىٰ غَيْرِ أَبِيهِ أَوْ يُرَىٰ عَنْهُ عَيْنَهُ مَا لَمْ تَرَىٰ أَوْ يَقُولَ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مَا لَمْ يَقُلْ. However, you know some people, you know the peers, the great peers, what do they say? Ya, I saw Allah Ta'ala in my dream. Ya, I saw Rasulullah in my dream. He told me this, he did this to me. I saw this sheikh in my dream, lying. So my Nabi says regarding dreams, إِنَّ مِنْ أَعْظَمِ الْفِرَةِ, from the greatest deception is when a person lies regarding what things? Number one, أَيَّدَّعِ الرَّجُلُ إِلَىٰ غَيْرِ أَبِيهِ. He makes his lineage to someone else. He doesn't say that I am the son of his right, real father to get some more honor. I am the son of such and such a haji sahab, such and such a person. Because, oh, that guy's a great big timer. I'm the son of Sheikh, I know, Abdul Qadir Jilani, for example. I am from the lineage. My name is Atiqur Rahman Jilani because I am connected to the lineage of Abdul Qadir Jilani. This amongst the greatest deception. Some people do this, astaghfirullah. Some people, they're not Sayyid, they call themselves Sayyid. Sayyid means from the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My name is Sayyid, such a name. But you're not a Sayyid. That is wrong. Greatest deception. My name is Sundim Sundim Uthmani because you're from the lineage of Hazrat Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. But you're not. Don't say that about yourself. My name is something Jilani, Peer, Peer-e-Azam, Peer-e-this, Jilani. You're not Jilani though. That's not your actual thing here. So why are you saying this for? Why do you refer yourself to someone that you're not from? This is the greatest deception. Number two was the father. Number two was, أَوْ يُرَىٰ عَيْنَهُ مَا لَمْ تَرَىٰ. He narrates a dream, but he did not see this dream.
I saw in a dream this thing happened. Allah gave me this glad tiding. Rasulullah came to me. This Sahabi came to me. That Sahabi came to me. They said to me, do this, do that. And he starts to narrate. And it's not real. You are amongst the greatest deceivers that my Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. Finally, أَوْ يَقُولَ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مَا لَمْ يَكُنْ. He attributes to the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that which Rasulullah did not say. Fabricated hadith. It has no bearing, no sanad. No sanad. And they narrate it. نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. This is completely haram, completely unacceptable. And it is very upsetting to know in our so-called Islamic scholarly circles, we have some people, on this special night, if you read 50 rakats of salah, you get this. My brothers, this is not in Quran and Hadith. Na'udhu billahi min dhalik. If you recite in the first rakat, Surah Fatiha 15 times Qul huwallah, 13 times Alhaakumut takathur, 15 times this. No, this is not in from the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is not mentioned in the Hadith. This is not from my Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Do not dare attribute it to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How dare you? How dare you make up certain things which is not from my Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? This is completely against. This hadith has been very light on this regard. Regarding the statements of Rasulullah, Rasulullah says, that person, man kadaba alayya muta'ammidan, intentionally, deliberately speaks lie against me, فَلْيَتَبَوَّأْ مَقْعَدَهُ مِنَ النَّارِ. He can happily go make his station in the fire of Jahannam. Go make your own seat. Go warm up your own seat in Jahannam. If I have not said it and you say I have said it, then this is completely wrong. And I'm sorry to say we have people like this, so-called Mawlanas, so-called Imam. My Nabi did not say this. Show me the Dalil. Where did my Rasul say? Which hadith do you find it? And here it is not a question of weak and strong hadith. No. Weak hadith is still hadith. If I have a weak hadith, that is weak not because of the statement of Rasulullah. It is weak because who has transmitted this hadith. So if, for example, right now from amongst us, say that someone here has a poor memory. Say Atiq has a poor memory. So if Yusuf Bai says, oh, I heard from Atiq who heard from Adil. Adil is a very strong person, very clever person. He has a good understanding of hadith. Yusuf Bai is a very good student. But it happened to be he had to come through me, who is a very weak person. My memory is weak. So Yusuf Bai will say, I narrate, I heard from Atiq, who heard from Adil. But Adil Bai's words are correct. And I happen to actually say the exact same wording. I narrated him correctly. But now those that will investigate this lineage and this hierarchy of teacher-student, they will say, Adil Bai, no problem. But in between, Atiq is very weak memory. Because of him, even though I said the exact same thing, because of Atiq now, this connection of this sentence that Adil has said and Yusuf has narrated from Atiq, from Adil, it has become a weak sentence. Because Atiq is weak. Hadith is not weak. The statement is not weak. The person giving this message is weak. So now the whole chain has become weak. Some weak hadith, it's weak. Yusuf narrates from Atiq, from Adil. Atiq is a weak person. That's one connection. Uzair narrates from Muhammad, from Atiq, and Atiq narrates from Adil again. Still weak, because I'm still there. So Uzair is another student who narrates from me. Now I find Umar. Umar says, oh, I also narrate from Atiq, who narrates from Adil. Shafiq Bai says, oh yes, I heard from Atiq, who heard from Adil. We have four different narrations, chains. I am in all of them. Hadith is weak, hadith is weak, hadith is weak, hadith is weak. But because four hadiths are all weak, when I've combined them together, though they are weak, I am going to give them the authenticity of it's a good hadith now. Because even though Atiq has been weak in all of the chains, because so many other students have reported that same saying, even though Atiq is weak, because there's not only one connection, we've got three, four connections of the same statement, so these four combined separately are weak, 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 weak. When they come together, they're hasan, they're good. We're going to accept it now. That's how hadith works. But then there are some people, Rasulullah said on this night, on this Shab-e Barat, Shab-e Qadr, Shab-e this, if you recite this amount of namaz, this amount of this, where did you find this? Where have you found this? Show me. Show me, then I will speak. Don't show me from your Bengali book. Don't show me from your Urdu book. Don't show me from your English book. Show me from the Quran Sharif and from the hadith of my Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then we can talk. Don't quote to me, such a sheikh said. Tell me what the sheikh al-shuyukh, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. Then we'll go forward. This is Quran and hadith. This is how we deconstruct Quran and hadith. This is ilm. This is scholarship. This is knowledge. So my respected friends, my point I'm trying to make to you is, do not take everything to be the statement of my Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If a person has seen Rasulullah and they are true on their claims, alhamdulillah. If you have not seen him, then make effort. How can you see the Rasul? So the ulama, let's end on this point. How can you see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in your dream? That's a very good question. A lot of people would die to see the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in their dream. How do you see him? Number one, connect yourself to the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sunnah. Your life has to be in his way. If you are practicing the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and you are very sincere about it, then because you have become, you have made sunnah beloved to you, you have made Rasulullah beloved to you also. So Allah, definitely inshallah, in your lifetime you will see the Rasul. There are some people, so many fortunate people, they see the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam every other day in their dream, bichare. That's how people are. Some people are like this. Allah make us amongst them people. Another, connect yourself to those things that are connected to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, the great commentator of Sahih Bukhari, says, I have hope in Allah, the closest to Rasulullah on the day of Qiyamah are the muhaddithun, the masters of hadith, the people that teach hadith. Why? One reason, he says, because what are we doing when we're teaching hadith? An Abi Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu sami'tu Rasulullahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qal. And when I explain the hadith, what do I say to you? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, my Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, they're the people who are reciting durood upon Rasulullah the most often. This is why they are closest to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How do we know this? My Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith, that person who recites durood upon me the most, he is the most closest to me. One companion, Jabir radiallahu anhu, went to Rasulullah. Ya Rasulullah, I have a ma'mulat, daily practices. From my ma'mulat, I have 1/4 for dhikr, of tasbih of Allah, subhanallah, subhanallah. 1/4 I have for the tahmid of Allah, I praise Allah, alhamdulillah. 1/4 I have for istighfar, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. And 1/4 of my daily practice, I send salutation upon you. I say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Rasulullah said to his companion, if you were to do more upon me, that will be better for you. He came back to Rasulullah, ya Rasulullah, I spend half my time in dhikr, and tawbah, everything, and half my time in durood sharif upon you, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah said, if you do more, it'll be better for you. He came back to Rasulullah. He said, ya Rasulullah, I spend 3/4 of my time in your durood and 1/4 in dhikr. In daily practice. I'm not talking about, you know, when you're standing and starting, you're doing tasbih anyway. This is a fixed time. He's doing this. Like, end of the night, I want to spend 15 minutes doing dhikr. This is his practice. So Rasulullah said, if you do more than that, it'll be better. He comes the next day. Ya Rasulullah, I spend my whole ma'mulat time, that specified time, only giving salutation upon you, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah said, this is best for you, I will intercede for you on the day of Qiyamah. That's where you go. That's muhabba for the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the muhabba, this is what Durood Sharif does. An incident narrated in hadith, reported by Hazrat Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. On the day of Qiyamah, Rasulullah said, that I will stand on the day of Qiyamah when the people, Allah Ta'ala, will be dealing with their hisab, their namai a'mal, the good deeds, bad deeds. There will be a servant, an ummati of mine. This hadith is weak in narration, but because it has been mentioned by a few others, it has a level where you can recite it out of virtue. It's the hadith of virtue. So Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, there will be an ummati of mine. He will be presented in the court of Allah, his hisab, his bad deeds will outweigh his good deeds. I will go in front of the mizan, the scale, with a piece of paper. I will place this piece of paper upon the side of the good deeds. All of a sudden the good deeds will outweigh the bad deeds. Small piece of paper, small piece of paper. And now the angel will make an announcement. Your good deeds outweigh your bad deeds, for you is Jannah, go towards Jannah. So then he will look back at me, this ummati, and will say to him, who are you? out of that shock, you know, when you just, yo, my whole kismet has changed. My taqdeer from Jahannam to Jannah, you're not going to recognize anyone right now. He said, who are you that you have done this for me? Rasulullah says, Ana Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I am Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What is that piece of paper that you put on my scale of good deeds? Rasulullah said, you've spent some time in giving salutation upon me. On that piece of paper, it says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That piece of paper was placed. This is the weight of that piece of paper.
Allah.
This is ishqi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Controlled love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not that love where it's just, hey, I love Rasulullah, one day, 2 days, finish. No. I praise my Nabi one day. No. Praise your Nabi every day. Love your Nabi every day. The greatest test and the greatest way of showing love is sunnah. Let your life be according to the way of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If that is the case, then you are a person that Allah will give goodness to. May Allah give us all the tawfiq to understand a lot of Durood Sharif. Before you sleep, try to recite a lot of Durood Sharif sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Durood Ibrahim is the most strongest Durood. Why? It is the most authentic in the hadith of Sahih Bukhari by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. The hadith of the Durood of, which Durood Sharif? The Durood Sharif of our Salah. So now, a question now. Why do we have other versions? Other versions are correct, no problem. Sallallahu ala Sayyidina Mawlana Muhammad, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, Assalamu alayka ya Rasulullah. All these other variations of durood are okay, no problem. We are not saying it is wrong, no problem, correct. However, if you were to ask me that, Mawlana, if I want something, I want the best of something. So now, if you want the best quality, the best thing, so if you enter the supermarket, you've got the normal Tesco brand, you know, the Tesco value brand. Then you've got the Tesco finest. Then you've got a brand. Then you've got the organic brand. Then you've got the top organic brand by another brand. That's the best. So if you wanted an orange, I could say to you, yeah, Tesco value, 15p orange, no problem, my brother, go. If I was being a bit more happy with you, take care, Tesco finest, Bichara. It's okay. A bit more, take this brand. If I really thought, you know what, this guy deserves, you know, good calcium and good vitamin D, I said, go for the finest one, organic one. So if you ask me, Mawlana, which Durood Sharif is the best, I cannot lie to you. The best Durood Sharif is Durood Ibrahim, found in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Sahih Bukhari. And that's why the best is only in Salah. In Salah, you will never find any variation. No one's going to come and say to you, I pray Durood Tanzihi, Durood this, Durood this. No, we all pray Durood Ibrahim. That is the best, that is why it is in Salah. So if it's the best in Salah, my brothers, obviously it's the best outside Salah too. So keep that in mind. So when you do Durood Sharif, if you're saying Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in that variation, after every 10-15, complete Durood. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammad. Recite the whole thing. Inshallah, there is hope you will see Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a dream. And can I say something to you? You don't have to be super pious to see Rasulullah. That's another problem. Only the sheikhs. No, many people see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in their dreams. I myself have seen Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in my dream. That doesn't make me pious. I'm telling you because I'm not pious. You don't have to be pious. But you can start off by reciting durood upon Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I still remember. I've only seen Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in my dream once. But to this day, I still remember how my Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looks. And the reason why I've seen Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I'll be honest with you, I'll tell you why. It is because of the barakat of hadith. Nothing else. Because of the barakat of this hadith, I've been doing this for over 4 years now. Riyadu Salihin, before this was Aladab al-Mufrad, every Friday, before coming to your masjid, it's been carrying on. We've had over 250 lessons now, consecutive lessons. Every Friday we have hadith lessons. So in that time, one of my teachers said to me, Mawlana Bilal sir, if you teach hadith and you can't see Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in your dream, then what are you teaching? What are you teaching then? If you can't see him and you're teaching hadith sharif and you can't see the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which book are you teaching? Which book are you teaching then? So what I'm trying to say to you is, obviously I have an attachment. It's a natural attachment and I'm teaching it. So through that barakah, Allah Ta'ala has given me the tawfiq to see my beloved Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam in my dream. That's all it is. So what I'm trying to say to you is, it's easy. You don't have to be super pious. You don't have to be wali of Allah. That's all I'm trying to make my point to you. May Allah give you all the tawfiq to understand. Mm-hmm. Attach yourself to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam correctly, through his sunnah, through his love, through his sunnah. Connect yourself to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and see how your life and my life becomes much more better. Allah give us all tawfiq to understand. Jazakallahu khairan. Next week we shall start Kitab al-Salam, the chapter of Salam.
May Allah Ta'ala accept. Subhanallah, bihamdi, subhanallah, nazeem, astaghfiruka, natubu ilayk, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyi al-azim. InshaAllah, Isha, salat at 10 o'clock. Yes.